Slido question. Once again, slido.com, keyword Cortland Council space. So right here we have the question, how many of your loved ones have been diagnosed with cancer? Looks like 85 to 90% of us at least know someone that we love that's been diagnosed with cancer. So with that, I am going to pass it on over to Jackie for our next presentation.
Thank you very much. Welcome back. I hope you had an opportunity to fill out some surveys and do some networking. Our next speaker is Courtney McCallan. Courtney is a public health educator with the Cortland County Health Department, and she has prepared a great presentation to help us dive a little deeper into some of the longitudinal data that the Cortland County process tracks using our county's cancer rates as an example.
Thank you. I'm Courtney. I've also been the coordinator of the work with Dean and the Narcan program for the past several years. Being a public health educator has been a wonderful experience for me here at the Cortland County Health Department for the last 14 years. I've been fortunate enough to work with a bunch of great people and many of you in this room. So without further ado, I appreciate you listening to me today. And at the end of the presentation, I will open it up to questions. So thank you. Today we'll be talking about cancer in Cortland County, the challenges and successes. The Cortland County Health Department is located on 60 Central Avenue. You can reach us at the administration office. You can contact me at the health education office as well. You can also check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. I'll be reading every page today. First, I wanted to introduce Cortland County as a whole in terms of age and gender. In Cortland County, the median age is 36.2 years, which is slightly lower than the New York State and Central New York median ages. Over 80% of the county population is 18 years and older. The age range 45 to 54 and 20 to 29 account for the highest percentages of population at 12.9 and 18% respectively. There are 2,444 children in the age of 5, which represents 5.1% of the population. In addition, there are approximately 4,359 persons aged 65 to 74, accounting for 90% of the total population. Women comprise of 51.5% of Cortland County, and men account for 48.5% of the population. Cancer incidence and mortality in Cortland County, all types. Cancer is the leading cause of death in Cortland County, compared to New York State, excluding New York City. Cortland County has a lower rate of incidence, but slightly higher mortality rate for all types of cancer. Within Cortland County, both the incidence and mortality rates for all types of cancer have been decreasing over time. Preventive cancer screening and education are important to reducing cancer in Cortland County. Preventable cancers that we'll be discussing today are breast cancer, lung cancer, prostate cancer, cervical cancer, and colorectal cancer. Breast cancer statistics in Cortland and in New York. According to the New York State Department of Health, breast cancer is one of the most common cancers among women in New York State. Each year, in New York, almost 16,000 women are diagnosed with breast cancer, and over 2,500 women will die is estimated that 1 in 8 women will develop breast cancer in their life. Men also get breast cancer, but it's very rare. About 150 men are diagnosed with breast cancer each year in New York State. Breast cancer screening, two of the most common. Two of the most common screening tools are a mammogram and a clinical breast exam. A mammogram is a low-dose x-ray of the breast. The most current guidelines suggest that women ages 50 to 74 years old should have a screening mammogram every 2 years. Women ages 40 to 49 years old are encouraged to talk to their healthcare providers about when and how often they should be screened for mammograms. Clinical breast exam is an exam that a healthcare provider uses when you use the to feel for lumps or other changes in the breast or armpit. Cortland County incidence mortality for breast, lung, bronchus, and prostate. You will see this graph a couple of times. It's a good thing to illustrate, and you'll be able to see as we talk about it further. Incidence of breast cancer in Cortland County is much higher than the mortality rate due to advances in early detection of breast cancer and improved treatments that can improve survival rates. Breast cancer successes in Cortland County. According to the CDC, the rates of cancer diagnosis and cancer deaths are impacted by changes in exposure risk factors, screening tests used, and improvements in treatments. At this time, all breast cancer screenings are covered under health insurance plans in New York State. We've come a long way. It used to not be that way. Increased access to mammograms and breast cancer screening by the use of mobile mammography and local hospitals in rural areas have also increased screening. The Cancer Services Program has also increased screening for women who do not have health insurance, and the Cancer Services Program has screened hundreds of women over the last 30 years who did not have health insurance. We now screen women who are 40 to 64 years old who are uninsured or underinsured through Cancer Services Program. Breast cancer challenges in Cortland County. According to the CDC, some cancer rates are going down, and in some cases, even though the rate is going down, the number of new cases and deaths are going up. This happens because the size of our population is growing and aging each year. As we go along, our parents' age is the baby boomer age. We will see more incidents of cancer, and hopefully the mortality rate will not increase too much. However, it's something that we need to focus on as a community and within healthcare and health department as well. Non-compliance with recommended screenings and follow-up, for example, breast ultrasounds, diagnostic mammograms, and breast biopsies can lead to higher incidence of breast cancer and later stage advanced disease. Next, I wanted to talk to you about lung cancer, radon, and smoking in Cortland County. Lung and bronchus cancer incidence rates for both men and women have remained higher than the rest of New York State, particularly due to the combination of high smoking rates and exposure to radon gas. For smokers, the risk of lung cancer is significantly due to the synergistic effects of radon and smoking. For this population, about 62 people in 1,000 will die of lung cancer, compared to 7.3 people in 1,000 for never smokers. Homes in Cortland County have the highest average basement and first level floor readings of radon. The average basement reading for radon level is 14.44 picocuries. At 4.0 picocuries, it is recommended that a home be mitigated for radon gas. The New York State Radon Program in Cortland County provides county residents with free radon kits. They can be obtained in Cortland County Health Department in room 115 and are available today during our breakout session. So you can obtain a radon kit during that time. Although tobacco has decreased in New York and the rest of the United States, tobacco use and tobacco-related disease continues to pose a threat to public health. The demographics of tobacco and other tobacco use are shifting as tobacco use is becoming more concentrated among people with low income and poor mental health. As you can see, the New York State and New York State, excluding New York City, rates of adult current cigarette smoking have declined vastly over the last 8 years. However, here in Cortland County, we have seen a steady rate of about 21.5 for the last 8 years. So it does show that we have some work to do. Lung cancer prevention. To reduce the risk, get your home tested for RaDaR. Don't start smoking or quit if you do. Avoid secondhand smoke. Evidence-based policy-driven approaches such as clean indoor air ducts and regulating where and how tobacco products are sold. Decrease tobacco initiation by youth, motivation of adult smokers to quit, and eliminate exposure to secondhand smoke. Lung cancer incidence and mortality. As you can see by the chart, 71.5 is the incidence, but about half of the people that are diagnosed with lung cancer will die from the disease. Lung cancer challenges. Cigarette smoking and vaping. For adults, the prevalence of cigarette smoking in Cortland County is 21.5%, higher than the prevalence of 17% in New York State, excluding New York State. Within Cortland County, the prevalence of cigarette smoking is higher among adults with disabilities, and the prevalence of cigarette smoking is lower among adults with an annual income less than $25,000. Prostate cancer statistics. Excluding skin cancer, prostate cancer is the most common cancer among men in New York. Each year in New York State, about 14,000 men are diagnosed with prostate cancer and almost 1,700 men will die of the disease. It is estimated that 1 in 7 men will develop prostate cancer during his life. Cortland County's prostate cancer incidence rate is 128.2 out of 100,000, and the annual death rate for prostate cancer in Cortland County is 3.2. The United States Preventive Services Task Force recommends that men screening ages 55 to 69 talk to their health care provider about the risk for prostate cancer and whether screening it is the best choice for them. Risks for prostate cancer include family history, race or ethnicity, and other medical conditions. The task force does not recommend screening for men age 70 and older. The two most used screenings in men are the PSA, which is a blood test, and the digital rectal exam, or a DRE. Prostate-specific antigen is measured, and the chance of having prostate cancer goes up as the blood level, the PSA level, goes up. But there's no set cutoff point that can tell for sure if a man does or does not have prostate cancer. Many doctors use the PSA cutoff point of 4 or higher when deciding if a man might need further testing, while others might recommend starting at a lower level, such as 2.5 or 3. If a PSA is more than 10, the chance of having prostate cancer is over 50%. A digital rectal exam, or DRE, is another screening test that can be performed to find abnormalities with a prostate. If further testing is recommended, individual factors will determine the next step. As you can see, the incidence of prostate cancer is much higher than the mortality rate from this. Some prostate cancer successes are prostate cancer is more likely to develop in older men. 6 in 10 cases are diagnosed in men who are 65 and older, and is rare in men under 40. The average age of diagnosis is about 66. Success is with prostate cancer, even though it's a serious disease, most men diagnosed with prostate cancer do not die from it. In fact, 3.1 million men in the United States who have been diagnosed are still alive. Other than skin cancer, prostate cancer is the most common cancer in American men. The American Cancer Society's estimate for prostate cancer for the United States for 2020 are about over 191,000 new cases of prostate cancer and about 33,000 deaths from prostate cancer. Unfortunately, there isn't an A rating for prostate screening. According to the U.S. Preventative Task Force, screening offers small potential benefit of reducing the chance of death from prostate cancer in some men. However, many men will experience potential harms of screening, including false positive results that require additional testing and possible prostate biopsy, overdiagnosis, and treatment. And treatment complications such as incontinence and erectile dysfunction. Cervical cancer screening guidelines. The guidelines changed several years ago. So these are the most up-to-date guidelines. So under 21 years old, no cervical cancer testing is needed. 21 to 30 year olds, Pap test every 3 years, 30 to 65 year olds, Pap test every 3 years, or Pap for HPV every 5 years. After 65 years of age, no testing is needed. This is a guideline, though, if there's been abnormal Paps or pre-cervical cancer conditions, these guidelines can change and increase the intervals of cervical cancer screening. Cervical cancer screening, two of the main testings that we do here in the United States, Pap test or Pap smear. Pap test looks for changes in cells taken from the cervix. If the Pap test result shows that cells are not normal and may become cancer, follow-up may be necessary. High-risk human papillomavirus testing, or high-risk HPV, is a test that looks for high-risk types of the HPV virus that causes most types of cervical cancer. The human papillomavirus, or HPV, is a very common sexually transmitted infection. About 80% acquire the HPV infection during their lifetime. HPV generally occurs soon after the first sexual activity and about 50% of the time. So just for instance, take a look around the room. If you took 80% of this room statistically, that would be how many people have been infected with HPV. It's an amazingly common virus that we have quite a stigma about. It's something that we as healthcare professionals and health department and community agencies that work with women and men who need to discuss this more openly. We need to reduce the stigma, and we also need to start really encouraging the HPV vaccine. We do have that vaccine available, and I'll explain more in a moment. Most HPV infections are asymptomatic and clear spontaneously, but the virus can spread during this time, hence the 80% of the population. Cervical cancer and HPV. About 79 million persons are infected in the U.S. About 14 million new infections occur each year, and about half of these are in persons 15 to 24 years old. There are about 37,300 HPV-related cancers diagnosed each year in the U.S. Most can be prevented with the HPV vaccine. For example, I want you to focus on the very last line. 91% of cervical cancers, 75% of vaginal cancers, 69% of vulvar cancers, 63% of penile cancers, 91% of anal cancers, and 70% of oral pharyngeal cancers. That's a lot of cancer that can be prevented with a vaccine. And right now, we have that available for our children. And the current recommendations, I'll get to in just a moment, but just put them in there for a second. Think about that. All of those cancers can be prevented with one vaccine. Cervical cancer incidence and mortality in New York State, approximately 840 cases of cervical cancer are diagnosed each year. sounds like a lot, right? 840. That's 840 women. That's 840 moms. That's 840 sisters, friends, neighbors. That's a lot. And 280 women will die from this disease annually. So all women are at risk for cervical cancer, but the risk increases for women over the age of 30 and varies across racial groups. Cortland County cervical cancer incidence rate is one of the lowest within the state. 3.6 out of 100,000, which is significantly lower than the New York State rate of 7.7 out of 100,000. And the annual death rate for cervical cancer in Cortland County is 0.5 out of 100,000, which really is great in a sense. We've done a lot, we have a lot of great screening, we have a lot of great tools, but we still have prevention and other pieces that we can add to making sure that the mortality rate remains low or zero at some point. So some of our cervical cancer successes, we do have cervical cancer screening. Many women, 82.2% of New York State women ages 21 to 65 years receive cervical cancer screening. And in accordance with the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendations, HPV vaccine is highly effective. It's a vaccination that is most effective when administered before exposure to the virus. So just as we give vaccinations for other things like polio and measles, mumps, rubella, especially, you know, we've been having an insurge of mumps in SUNY Cortland. We see that these things creep up every once in a while. But before exposure happens, the vaccine prevents new HPV infections, and the majority of HPV-associated cancers are caused by two HPV strains, 16 and 18, and they're all included in all of the HPV vaccinations. The HPV Vaccination Advisory Committee immunization practices recommends that males and females ages 11 to 12 years old be vaccinated. I know that when we had done rounds within the healthcare system, we talked with parents, we talked with medical providers. Parents were not exactly excited about discussing this with their 11 to 12 year old child, which I get, because your child never partake in any sexual activities until they're about 75. I got it, no problem. My kids also will not. However, my kids have been vaccinated for HPV-related disease because I see the prevalence in what I do. Over the last 14 years, I've seen countless women have biopsies, colposcopies, cervical cancer, and it's preventable. It wasn't then, but it is now. Baseline data for 2019 for 13-year-olds who completed the vaccination series is 33.5% in Cortland County. It's just 33.5%. And having a vaccination before contact is incredibly important. I think as an educator, we need to remove the stigma about HPV and how HPV is spread and how people come in contact with it, because really, it doesn't matter. We have a vaccine that can help prevent cancer. And educating parents, caregivers, and medical professionals that the HPV is cancer prevention is one of the key points, and I think we miss that sometimes. But with education, working with Jacobi Center and other healthcare facilities and other agencies that we work with, we have been able to help increase that number over the last several years. So colorectal cancer screening guidelines. I've worked in this program for many years as well, and women ages 50 to 75 are at average risk for colorectal cancer should be screening for colorectal cancer. There's different testing methods that can be used. There is the fecal mechanical testing, which many offices foam test, especially if you have a client or a patient who is unwilling to have a colonoscopy. We always say that the best test is the best test that gets done, that's the best prevention. People with family history or other risk factors for colorectal cancer screening, for colorectal cancer, to talk to their physician about screening at an earlier age. The average annual death rate for colorectal cancer in New York State is 13.0 out of 100,000. This is for both male and females combined. The annual incidence rate for colorectal cancer in New York State is 38.9 out of 100,000 for both males and females combined. The New York State colorectal cancer incidence rate for men is 45 out of 100,000 and 34 for women out of 100,000. The average annual death rate for colorectal cancer in Cortland County is 14.8 out of 100,000. This is both for males and females. The annual incidence rate for colorectal cancer in Cortland County is 43.0 out of 100,000 for both males and females. So this chart you can see over the last 16 years of data that you can see, colorectal cancer screening has steadily increased in the last 16 years. That has a lot to do with the educational piece within our communities and with your physicians talking to you and encouraging you to do some type of colorectal cancer screening. As a side note, as you can see, it says changes in the BRFSS methodology. I just wanted to explain what that was to you. They added data collection in 2011 with cellular telephones as part of the data collection analysis. So that's really all that was. And colorectal cancer challenges, as you can see, we did not unfortunately make the screening rate for colorectal cancer. It did not meet the prevention agenda's 2018's objective of 80% by 2018. We were getting closer at 68.5%, and when I first started 14 years ago, it was much lower than that. I used to not be able to like give you a gift card to get it taken care of, to get your kit back. So we made a lot of great strides, so I'm very pleased by that. So we have made great strides in terms of cancer screening, reducing the burden of cancer incidence and mortality. We will continue to collaborate with community agencies and the public to promote health, prevent disease, injury, and disability while enhancing the quality of life for the community. If you have any questions or need more information, you can contact me at the information above, or you can, I'll lead to the breakout session, and you can ask Nicole, who will be heading up. Thank you.
We do have a couple of questions from Slido. We're only going to take a few. Again, it's a massive effort.
Is this better?
Not really. All right, I am going to ask a couple of questions in the sake of time. Remember, we do have breakout sessions later on, like Courtney mentioned. The first question we have here are, how many vaccines are in the HPV vaccine series?
Ooh, that's a good one. Okay, so in the original vaccination that people had gotten beforehand, there's been the first vaccine was a 2.0 vaccine. The first vaccine had four strains of the HPV virus. The new one has nine, and that actually is the one that's used the most now. There are still some physician offices that use four. But we do have the Gardasil 9 that most people are using.
We also have, what type of support systems for individuals and families facing cancer are not currently available in Cortland? Where are the gaps?
So I do know that there has been some gaps along the way with support systems and counseling. I know that we do have support group that is in Cortland County. We
questions out there? All right, well, once again, thank you so much, Courtney, for coming up. We'll have that breakout session later. And I'm going to pass it on over to Jackie.
So our next presentation topic was selected when the community assessment team was reviewing trends in the health indicator data for Cortland County, as was captured in the Cortland County report cards. The current area of concern is childhood obesity rates in our community. So there's been several initiatives that have been ongoing or starting up and continue to be working on childhood obesity rates. So we're really pleased that we're able to get a couple people that are working very hard in this area here with us. So I'd like to introduce Bob Capp. I'm sure most of you know Bob Capp. He's an organic farmer, farm manager at the Warner Bean Street Farms here in Portland. And Emily Fusco? She is the Farm School AmeriCorps member at Cornell Farm Extension.
There are 42% of all the United States school districts surveyed is a total of 42,580 schools currently participating. So next I want to talk a little bit about the economic impact of farm to school. So farm to school has proven to have a very strong multiplier effect into the local economy. So for the entire National Farm to School program, school spending on local food has driven over $1 billion in local economic activity. Depending on the different counties, programs generally generate between 60 cents to $2.16 for every dollar spent on local food, and that's back into the local economy again. And a 2015 census data evaluation indicated that between 2013 and 2014 alone, $600 million worth of local food was purchased by a farm to school program, and the program has only grown since and is continuing to grow. And then specific to the New York State Farm to School Program is something called the New York State 30% Initiative. So what this means is if food school administrative staff purchase 30% or more of their total food costs on New York State produce, they would be eligible for an additional 25% reimbursement for each lunch meal that they serve. So this is just a really great incentive for schools to be taking advantage of all the New York food that we have to offer. And then lastly, farm to school opens up a new market for farmers to sell to, which is beneficial for the farms as well as the economy. And next I'm going to talk a little bit about the environmental impact and the social equity impact. So farm to school will help increase the awareness of our food system's impact on the environment and the environmental health and economic benefits that are attached to local food systems. So this awareness will help reduce food waste and put less food into landfill. It will help to reduce the carbon footprint of food transportation and transportation costs, and will help to reduce food insecurity. So regardless of what the home situation may look like, every student will have equal access to healthy, whole, nutritious foods while they are at school. So food insecurity is not simply just hunger, but rather a scale of different experiences. So it generally begins with an individual or a family worrying about their ability to have access or purchase the food that they need. And then from there, it escalates to compromising the quantity or quality of the food that they're able to have access to, and then eventually becomes skipping meals or entire days of eating and experiencing hunger. So the next two slides that I'm going to discuss have data based on the 95th and 85th percentiles of BMI, and I just wanted to quickly go over that to make sure everyone is on the same page. So just to start off, you calculate the BMI indicator using the weight and the height of the student, and that is the vertical numbers that will be on this graphic. And then you correlate the BMI indicator with the student's age, which is these horizontal numbers. And then that basically plots you onto this graphic. And that first red section is the 95th percentile, and that is for obesity. And then the yellow section is the 85th percentile, and again, the lines begin at the bottom. So the yellow is the 85th, and that is for overweight. The green section is the 5th percentile, and that is considered healthy. And then below that is below the 5th percentile, the brown section is underweight. So this first one is the overweight, so that's the 85th percentile. And this first two bars are all of the students of Cortland County, which is green, compared to nationally in orange. So as you can see, Cortland County is about a 7-point percent difference for Cortland County's higher overweight rates than national. lacking behind the national averages, and those healthy habits are not being formed. So the following quote is from a 2015 USDA survey and research study, and it reads, "The various activities of farm to school contribute to an integrated approach to learning centered on food, agriculture, and nutrition, which independent research and testimony from teacher and school officials indicate can improve students' formation of healthy habits and increase the likelihood that they will make healthy choices." And then a very important component of the success of the Farm to School program is to have the support of our local farmers. So I hand it over to Bob.
All right. How's everybody doing out there? Yeah, cool. Hi, I'm Bobcat. Is there anybody here that lives on a farm or grew up on a farm? Raise your hand. Anybody? For you? Anybody want to be farmers when they grow up? Does anybody here eat food?
Yeah.
All right, yeah, so we all eat food, right? So that's one of the things I love to do with the kids is just reminding everybody that, you know, we all eat, but, you know, not all food is created equal. So, and I know they put us right before lunch. I'm sure you guys are getting hungry. We're almost there. So for those of you that don't know me, I'm Bobcat. I'm the co-owner of Main Street Farms. We started 10 years ago, just right around the corner in Homer. And we grow organic vegetables. And I started the farm with my partner, Alan Gamelman. And we both came from an educational background working with children. So we knew when we wanted to start the farm, not only did we want to grow healthy, delicious food for our community, but also to go into the schools, be involved in the community, come to events like this, and talk to people about food and forming healthy habits and things like that. So I've been doing this for 10 years now, all over Cortland, wherever would let me come into their school or do events. And we do the yearly events like Ag Extravaganza for fourth graders, and I've seen every fourth grader in the county for years. And to sixth graders, they do the conservation field days, and we work a lot with the New Visions kids, the high school seniors, and I've seen kids that have come through this progression of all these different age groups. And it's cool to see them, you know, they go away to college and then all of a sudden they'll show up at the farmer's market. I do farmer's market in Syracuse every Saturday. And they'll show up to the farmer's market and be like, you know, I never liked vegetables until I came to your farm. And now all of a sudden, you know, I love them. So it's cool to see that progression for some students. And we've even had some people, one young woman as a high school senior, you know, her mother asked if she could do an internship at our farm, and she warned us that she was a little bit wild, but she was very intelligent, and we were a little hesitant at first, but we bought her out. She interned with us for an entire year, and she went away to Paul Smith College, and you know what she ended up majoring in? Agriculture, and she now runs their barn for their student farm. So it's really cool to, you know, not only be inspiring people to eat healthy, but also trying to inspire the future of farmers. And so throughout the 10 years, we've done a lot of education. We've worked with Seven Valley Health Coalition for a long time. And now to have the buy-in from the state with the buying local food in the schools, that's really exciting. And to have Cornell Cooperative Extension working with us now, where Emily and I are now formulating some programming that we can do year after year. We've reached out to every school in the county and at least started conversations with them, asking them, how can we help you? What resources can we provide? Because some schools, like say Marathon, they already have a pretty vibrant agricultural program where they're already doing a lot of things, but some schools not so much. So we're working with schools on coming into the classrooms, doing education, doing taste testing. And then one of my favorite is helping them start school gardens. So there's not necessarily money in the grant for us to pay for the gardens, but if we help them raise the money to build them, then we can come in and educate the kids right in the gardens. And to me, that's the best, because you're not only teaching them about the healthy food, but you know, you're getting them active, getting them moving, and really that's how you get the buy-in for lifelong, you know, commitment to eating healthy. So it's really exciting times for me, I think, here in Cortland County to be a farm-to-school educator. I've been working towards this for 10 years now, and it's really awesome to see it all kind of just snowballing and getting bigger and bigger every year. So, you know, is there anything else that's supposed to talk about? Well, I'll be happy to answer questions at the end.
Yeah. So just to wrap just to wrap it up, the main goals of the Farm to School program are to support community-based food systems, strengthen local and family farms, and improve children's health and education through the knowledge of their food and the food system and help them to form those healthy habits. So, do we have time for a few questions? Or
do you have time for any questions?
Do you need a fact?
That would be great. Thank you. All right, so we have a few questions on Slido here. The first one is, are the farm to school programs available to preschool programs?
Yes, all school ages. All
right. We also have, it makes sense to start developing healthy eating habits earlier than school age. What can be done to connect with young children?
So I definitely agree with that. I think the earlier you start, the better. It's easier to form habits when you're young and more impressionable. So I guess to help with that, we can sort of gear the farm to school program to really educate on the younger end. We currently are doing all ages right now, or whoever's interested. I would like to try and focus younger. I think we have done kindergarten a few times so far, not preschool yet. But really just introducing them to like what local food is, why it's important for your health, gain the brain power you need, and just, doing fun activities with them and trying to connect that positive correlation between food and how it benefits them at a young age.
Can I say something real quick? So this isn't a question, but it's just a supplemental Emily just says. Matt Whitman from CACTC, they have a literacy program, and they have some literacy efforts too, and they have a program called Books to Grow On. And the most recent Books to Grow On, the Sun Valley sponsored, we focused on that in particular. So it's a book, I'm going to forget what it's called.
Eat Your Colors.
And then we did an infographic sheet that's inserted into the book that gives parents tips on how to use starter, even with infants, to talk about and encourage your children from a very young age to be eating a wide variety of colors, which then obviously leads to produce, and those are given out at well child visits, is that correct? So that's just one more thing that's happening in the county to try to address that.
So we've got another question here. Do you guys travel outside of Cortland County for the farm to school programs?
That should be good.
So the farm to school program we're working on is specifically for Cortland County. I have gone to Tioga County just with the Broome County Farm to School program when I first began, just to kind of introduce myself to how it works. But this grant is focused on Cortland County.
Thank you.
Just a question, when you're working with the children, are there any vegetables that are more popular than other vegetables?
Well, for me, I think the most popular vegetables are the ones that the kids are able to pull from the ground when we get them on the farm. I think that's anything you can pull right off the plant. They love things like peas and cherry tomatoes and things like that. But every kid's different, and that's, everyone's got their own unique palate. So it's hard to say that, one particular vegetable does good with kids, because some kids love certain things and some don't like other things. So it's all about finding what you like.
And when we do our taste test, we try and enforce a don't yuck my yum type of philosophy. So every student can try it and not worry about someone else being like, ew, that's gross, or why do you like that? It's good to enforce that.
Well, thank you both again for coming up and talking. Once again, we'll have the breakout session. And I know talking about food right before lunchtime is kind of cool.
So we hope that you all enjoyed our wonderful presentations this morning. We had some great presenters. Can we all give them another round of applause? So as we move into lunch, I want to remind you that we're going to have a brief plenary session. So once everyone has been served and seated, we will have a speaker. And we're hoping that you can stay for the afternoon sessions that will begin right at 1 o'clock. The goal of the breakout sessions are to hold more of a round table to give us all more of an opportunity to discuss what we've learned this morning, to ask any remaining questions of the presenters and see what new ideas, gaps, or other issues that arise. If you're not able to stay for the afternoon, just a reminder to please complete the hard copy of the evaluation work over the sunvalleyshealth.org website to do the evaluation for today's event and to take our surveys. We keep talking about data, and you know, data does spur action, but we really need the input from the community on all of these things that we're doing, because the data by itself just gives us just the data. So please help us with the surveys. So in the meantime, we hope you enjoy lunch, and also I want to take the opportunity to thank our sponsor, Care Compass Network, which is our sponsor for the forum today, and Sally Clevin is here, so thank you very much, and all of Care Compass Network that has done a lot for this community. We all have benefited greatly from that organization, so we're happy that you're going to be sticking around. So without further ado, we are going to...
Free for all.
It's fine.